pounds of steel, people.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, more than you're going to have to deal with from a person.
When you throw, you start with that. And then you work your way up to the bigger one.
It's not okay.
Alright, the next exercise, I like the little fun names, you know, the how I am with that, it's more fun that way, a little more exciting. I call this Phoenix Eye Punching, and you can do it for speed, you can do it for control, do it for conditioning. No matter what you do, you're going to get some of all of that in the exercise. And then you have. I have a big anchor. I'm anchored well. And then eventually, you want your arms not here, but here. It's going to take a while. And you know what? We probably should have started with a lighter barbell.
Not I mean, you know, you're already.
Right, already there.
That's different, though. It's going to roll in the top.
Not that you can't do it, but it might be easier to get the coordination down with the lighter weight. Good job, Matt. Anthony Sensei?
Yes.
Can we try that one?
Yes.
The same principle applies.
Why did you get one of your tempering? Why else did you think this?
Not what I was now, thinking. What you're going to do here, you can control, right? Your posture, your core, your breathing, and your positioning so that. You're not out here, right? You're not doing this stuff. You're right underneath. And you're well controlled.
Phoenix, right? So you tap in.
Yep. For us, yeah. Basically,
the way we watching, do it, if not, you're gonna pinch. I know Phoenix, right? Yeah, we have multiple ones. Yeah, we'll get that one.
You're going to pinch it?
That's one. So it could be like this too.
Between that thumb and that nail. Between this thumb and this nail. You want the tension to be there.
Wow, that's the first time.
Like this, or which way?
This is the way we do it.
Really?
If the thumb is on this finger, and then you're pinching between this thumb and that finger.
Oh, okay.
It's about as close as I can get.
Actually, it's technical now. With a punch, a hit, and pinch, and then
there.
Try to really elbow down and try to post it up so you get your bridge.
That's what I like. I'm trying to figure out why it's
your fingers.
Feel
that? Feel that tendon? That tendon is what I use to protect the hip.
I can't take it in.
It's crazy.
See that? See how it's bone now?
Yeah.
Now it's tight.
It goes all the way down.
All the way down. Same thing on the shins. I'm going to pull it up so I have my tendon protecting my bone as my shield. I'm coming in to hit. And then I'll point and kick so it closes the bone.
Oh, I see. So.
As the bar flies out the front door.
That's why I do Phoenix Strike like this.
And really work on getting that turn all the way out as a basic exercise, but not letting this happen. What you have is you've got the tension here across the chest, pulling your elbow down, and then you have this hand pulling up, not letting it rotate out. So this is this way, right? And the arm is this way, the hand is this way, so you're doing this. And that's where you're getting that tension. Thank you. And of course, if you guys want to go crazy later, you can use the Olympic bar, but I want to give everybody a chance to this so we can move on and kind of touch on the next exercise.
Okay.
if someone can work with Nika later and show her the first stuff that we did.
Okay. So
starting here.
Here.
And Sensei, how much have you worked with them as far as the gathering of the strength and the exploding?
Only the very upper rank people.
Upper rank?
Yeah.
So with
like wire stuff and things like that, he knows it, she knows it.
Would it be safe to just have them to drop and then push?
Yeah.
Okay. For now, just come in and close in and then think expand and push. And then expand and push out. And it should roll down and catch. This thumb should be in the middle of that finger, and then this should be just pinching.
Like I can't do it where I sit.
That's good, that's good. That's how it is.
Ow. Okay. And then you bring it back in?
And then you shrink and you draw in. It's basically draw, explode.
Stuck.
Draw, explode. It takes a lot of practice. And one thing you can use, you can kind of just drop and they'll roll in, and then you can bring it forward and it'll come down. And Sensei will correct anything that I've said that's out of line, and he will show any kind of changes or refinement will come from Sensei.
And the elbow.
Out the front door! There's a good punch.
The elbows are in the same position as this, right?
Basically your upper gait, whatever your basic position is. Now, some is a little more open, some are higher. Like Guochol, they tend to be a little higher, right? We tend to be a little kind of lower. And Guochol, they tend to almost flare out the wrists on their base. Ours are, we come up a little bit. But I think Guochol is one of our ancestors. Kind of our stuff came through them at some point. So it's just a little slight change. Oh, our base is about here where the shoulder and the top of the fist are about there. We're a little outside 90, whereas the Guochol can be a little closer to me, and they sit a little higher, just a little bit. And their wrists tend to be turned more, and it's just this amazing stuff. Just a little different than what we do. But I think they're one of our ancestors, so to speak. As far as their actual history in China, nobody really knows. A lot of theories, but I think that Hungar, Guochol, Crane, and even Wing Chun, some of those ideas are very, very...
Chong Fa styles, too.
You would know more than I would, Sensei, but just those things.
Chong Fa is like pretty much a lot of those things together. You know what I mean? Chong Fa is like the base for like Hunga, Wing Chun, all the southern styles, the way they move, Chola Foot, all the families. And the rumor is, of course, nobody knows the real history, that Chong Fa had a big play in the birth of karate.
Oh, sure.
The actual karate styles. But nobody can connect the two because, of course, you know, people were hiding, giving fake names.
Right.
You know, running away from the government. They don't want to get killed. So things like that were going on. So they did a lot of, you know, hiding stuff. And only, and, you know, like you said it perfectly. As generations go on, what happens?
Changes. A little flavor change here. Right. I like it this better. I like that better.
And then you lose that, you know, who actually started it, sure. where it came. But, you know, that's the rumor. But there's no connection there, though, history-wise, to find it.
Yes, sir.
You know, then you have Japanese going into Korea, burning everything. You know, it's talking about it came from Japan. You know, you had stuff like that going on too.
Well,
so
when Japan was founded by the Koreans, you know, but you don't ever say that in Japan.
Oh no,
no, they're migrant Koreans.
Yeah,
you know, centuries and centuries and eons ago, but they originated in Korea.
Right,
but don't ever say.
I looked at three different sources and I posted them on our website and they said the same thing.
You
can argue about that all day, who cares?
But it'd be funny because you know, they all came from one place, it's obvious, you know what I mean? But all of them. Common ancestor.
Chinese wrestling?
Watch out, you know, maybe
you're
this point.
Yourself, right?
Like what?
So it's like this. You know what's funny? We saw this on Ancient Aliens or something.
That's what I'm talking about, right? You see what I'm doing now?
Everybody in like China and Korea, they all thought Mount Fuji was an awful place.
Turn this way.
but your elbow, you want to turn the
opposite. Even people in Japan, they don't go up to the base of Mount Fuji. Because there's some place called the Suicide Woods.
Yeah,
surrounds the entire volcano. You go in there and there's such negative energy there that people go there to commit suicide. Yeah.
Fun stuff.
The Koreans had a death wish, and that's why they went to Mount Fuji and became Japanese.
All right. The true history.
I gotta be on my report card.
That's the attention you want.
Do you guys ever see like the Egyptian paintings when they're like this?
And you be okay with
same exact technique as everyone else.
Kind of catching them to bite a little bit when you come down, so you stay
fighting.
Yeah.
When you're punching, you're up. You've projected force. Bow. Like just straight destructive force. And that's kind of an area where we can train that with a whip.
That was a good bounce.
Who else's turn?
Jack's the only one that hasn't done yet.
Yes, no.
Oh, you haven't done yet?
Jack.
Thank you.
Now watch the project.
Hey, you know, anybody that's got my email, my phone, I have a YouTube site where if you have questions or something, call or send me a message on the Facebook Messenger. Uh-huh. What you'd like to see, I can film it and put it up there.
Cool. Okay.
So, and there's a YouTube site named for the MapleCon Dojo. And anything I can do to share or work with you guys, I really want to.
I appreciate that.
So, whatever, wherever we can do.
Same thing for us, then. Do you want to see anything?
Well, yeah, I do. See, because I'm really a greedy guy. Wait till I start asking questions to Sensei. Like, Sensei, I've come down three times, can you teach me this?
Slave.
You are, but first try to make it move smoothly and just roll out. So you want inertia, but you
act like you gotta go to work or something.
And try to come here at the end. And it's hard. Make sure your base is strong, your boot stance. And let it roll back in. And roll forward.
She's gotta pay for her eating habits.
That's right, you guys.
It's hard. You've gotta kick it up and then enough inertia to where it's smooth, but it comes out. You're punching slightly up.
She eats.
It takes practice. Find control of the movement.
Okay, that's a good question.
Okay, now let it come back. Now this time, pop it out. You can turn
yours. That's what I was
thinking. Well, you got to do an explosive pop.
You try to cut everything.
Still
kind
of tired.
Step. Okay, I'm gonna
go sleep now.
Yeah,
one more
time. Yay! It just takes a lot of practice. And Sensei is gonna refine things and show you how to a little tweak here and there. And again, the barbell is the benchmark there is when you're doing three sets of, you know, good repetitions to 13, 18, then yeah, you can start adding some weight. But going over 90 pounds, 25 on each side, I don't see need to ever go any higher than 95. Because I did, and it was an accomplishment, but it didn't have any function. It was just heavy weight. At a certain point, your nerves have done...
Bet it made you look like a beast, though.
Yeah, people would freak out when they'd see it. And I've got plates on the bar, and you're rolling it up and down my arms. What's wrong with that guy?
Somebody peed in his burn face this morning.
Okay, so moving on. You guys earlier you asked and talked about the putting the concrete in the can and making mistakes. They call that chi chi or strength stone. What I prefer to do is use a hammer. And the reason I prefer that, because it gives orientation to the weight. You have a forward and a back. And you're martial artists. In Okinawa, I love the Okinawa, but Okinawa is that is a self-defense system. It comes from, it's a martial art too, but their training and everything is really focused and keyed in on more cruder things and is more simple based on just defense principles. In their application of it. So the tool they did, they took away a lot of the things that the Chinese had done that were necessary for someone that was going to go in battle. right? So if the Chinese are training with the strength, they have, may I use your weapons?
Yeah. What am I doing wrong?
I don't know.
When they're doing their strength exercises that I'll show you,
they can't go down.
They come in, right? They'll come to here, rotate out, down the middle, outside, down the middle. They'll use a round stone. Well, because you use weapons, I use a hammer so that there's an orientation to the weight. So when we start doing the overhead exercises, it translates to the actual weapon and not just a round disc. They don't have any connection, the mind, to the weapon because it's round. And they don't use bladed weapons for the most part, the vast most part. Okinawans, there's no bladed weapons. Pointing, the side, honfa, you know, bow, nunchaku, but no hack and slash, right? So they had no need for an orientation of the weapon. But the exercise that I want to inform you guys is we come center, and it's punch here. Punch, but this is with a sledgehammer, right? And then we have come back to base position, the external and internal rotation on the hand. With an 8-pound sledge on an 18-inch lever, it's a lot of weight.
Right.
And you build up slowly to that. You'll take it out, bring it up, drop it down, point it up, drop it down, point it up, working this aspect. From here, it's drop, come to a shield position, come around to a strike. Drop, strike. This side is like an abanico almost, to a shield, to coming around to an overhead strike. Drop, down, strike. And with the 8 pounds at the end of that 18-inch handle, right, there's a lot of weight at the end of that. So the rotational axis is here. You're the rotational axis. So you're training your wrists and your forearms and all that strength, but because you're martial artists, and I'm not knocking anybody, by the way, with that. That's not an insult to anyone. That's just, they didn't have any force to go down. But because you're a martial artist, with the martial tools, the blades, and the weapons of war, and you're creating that machine, it's better to have an orientation.
Right.
So any sledgehammer, you can do all these exercises with that. I didn't have the presence of mind to do that today, to bring that. I should have. I've created my own. My hammer weighs 25 pounds. The whole thing weighs 25 pounds. It's a 10-pound head with two sleeves, and it's got a truck ball hitch on the bottom. And it's the hammer weighs 25 pounds. So it's a brutal workout. But it's amazing, the stronger you get with your hand and your arm techniques, if someone's got more skill, sometimes that brute strength can save you. Because when you're in trouble and you're in a pinch, sometimes it's nice to just be really, really strong and then run. run.
You know, that develops your strength, right? And then all you guys have done weapons and all. You pick up a kwanda, you pick up whatever weapon, you start working on it, and you really haven't developed that strength. What happens? Your forearm gets numb. Right? You go, dang, this is why? Because you haven't developed your strength. That's what that does. And then when you pick up that weapon, it doesn't feel like that no more.
Yeah, but as this compared to that sledgehammer, it's going to be like, ooh. Now, with this, I can make a sandwich. But you get the idea. And I also suggested, Sensei, that they may want to get a bowling pin or two or three from a bowling. They'll give you the old crack ones. They'll give them away. And what I do is I train my legs against kicks with those. Just let them drop for the front kick, side kick, and then that. And they can also use it as a strength tool. You can grab the ends of it and work the legs out and those things. So that's what we would do to finish up with the hammer. We don't have one, but I would like to go over a couple of things that we can use weight plates for. If you guys are interested in continuing what I do for the hand strength, you guys want to see some balance?
Mm-hmm.
Excellent.
Can
we
get you some lunch real
quick? You need the other
time? Yeah.
My hands are so big that these are a little small for me, but I can take one hand, one finger out and make it work.
And what we'll do is we'll take turns and I'll kind of show you what these do. This is in some relation to the, I'll call it the crane kind of hands that you saw with the rolling of the bar.
Yeah.
And we will do, we'll walk up and down the floor with these. You can change your stances, you can change your length and your depth to suit whatever your need is at the time. Okay. But we're going to come up and strike, up and strike, step, strike. And I actually got this through Frank Seaford. Up, pop, up.
Oh, that looks like it would be great on my shoulder. Oh.
It's actually very cool. Safe position for
children.
As long as you don't get weak and start to flare out.
Yeah, don't do this. It's more riskier.
I'm going to Sonic. I'm just going to
You're fine. You're fine, sir.
No, it's good.
No, man, you were fine. You gave good depth into
it. I was going to go to Sonic. Just right there.
Some people's ball and socket. Mm-hmm. It extends out a little bit more, so this brings some.
But
this is a totally neutral
position. Yeah.
Very strong. You won't hurt your shoulder at all. Try turning your shoulder. And I come just straight up like that.
Oh, that's fine. Give me a burger. I want a burger.
Feel something like that. Anything with green chili.
What do y'all want?
There you go. He likes green chili. Put the chili.
Anything with green chili is good.
You got it.
Anything without green chili is good for me.
The white boy over here can't handle
it. The gabacho in the corner.
You're going to wear
he's German.
I'm making a lunch real quick.
Oh, okay.
I'm a
mixed breed.
The Sonic right there.
That'll be good.
It's Thursday. Yeah, the Bible will get one for jeans.
So you're coming here?
No.
Right. See how he's coming to the side?
You could just
yeah.
Sideways. And then you just go straight up.
Yep. Have you ever seen this? That is advanced, and that's where you see this occur. And it may not happen in water casting, it'll happen in long run. In one of the exercises. You have buffalo punch, you have sun punch. Which is the one where it comes up.
Gold.
That's a dragon.
Well, that's I thought that was gold.
It's long, it's way out.
No.
Tree?
I'm not sure.
Cactus? Wood.
You see you gotta forgive me guys, because remember I'm not trained in hunting. I've seen it. Frank Sifu taught me Go to you using Hungar as a vehicle. I don't know Hungar. I don't know the techniques. I know them as they related to me, as he taught me my system through the Hung. So I'm not trained in Hung.
That's fine.
So I may be saying things that are technically inaccurate or that are off, but I just want you to make the association. What I can do is I can give you a way to connect it, that's all. Right, so technically I'm not going to be accurate on a lot of stuff, but just know the associated movements, okay? One of the things that I work with, let me hold on to the warriors.
We just have this part right here.
A little bit.
But not wide.
It's just a little bit.
Well, and that may have been something just specifically for me too.
Uh-oh.
Okay, so let's say we have a punch here, right? And then another punch comes in. Okay. And there's where that third maneuver had come in, right? So I was taught. Here. Here, right? So I was taught. One, and then the next was here. Well, the third one.
Okay, yes,
here.
I see the move now. I know it's in crane.
So wherever they're at, wherever those movements are at, things were taken down and broken up to me and given me a part that related to stuff I was doing.
Okay.
And I made that connection back to the old you. Yeah, yeah.
I saw you moving that. Got this.
Okay, so looking at that, the same thing occurred here with long arm technique coming up. And with that, let's say you throw a punch, okay? You throw a second punch. It's here. But when I hit this movement at the impact, feel like that. And because of that motion, the snap at the end, per se, causes this to break your brachii instead of just move. Right? Because if it's just, if it's blunt movement, maybe the elbow, tighten up. If it's just this, it feels, you know, a force. If it's this, it does that. So what we're looking at, it's this. Okay? And that is found here.
That's what I was listening
to. Right? It can happen down, right? It can happen up. So if I'm coming up, it can hit. If I'm coming down, the same force coming up has a negative side. Okay, so let's say here, I come up. Right? Now this time, I used the negative side of the force. If you look at this, what's it like I'm doing with my hand? How am I hitting? Like with a hammer, like I'm chopping on something, right? But notice what it does here.
It raises that side. It opens
it up. Right? So I can be hitting something with effect here. Right? Or I can be hitting harder with the top by forcing this down. See how that positive and negative works? Okay, so I hit this one. Now, this one comes here. So by hitting this down, I'm increasing the impact here by doing that. Now, if you just did this, it's not wrong, but this can add the impact point.
There it is.
Yes. The sharpness. Okay. So, is there a positive and negative side of that?
Yes.
So, instead of just blunt force, it's sharp force.
Right.
I'm making this stronger. Okay. Same thing can be said for coming up, but now watch, we're going to go positive, positive. So when it's coming up, we're adding to it, not on the negative side, but on the same side. So as it's coming up, I'm going to, which is just for argument's sake, instead of come up and add to it by hitting here this way. But if you look at this, is coming up, right? But this part here is also going down. So you're getting both here. You see how you're getting the advantages of both? Now that's a swing, right? If you come and you pop that.
Yeah. I can feel that right in the travel straight through.
Sure does. Yeah. The vibration is going to go through. So, now what we're going to do is we're going to take the weights. Which weights did we have?
The 10 pounds.
That's right.
Chris,
those are too
get
small
away.
Straight up.
Okay, just so you know, I got the tension on there, so when you move it, you move it.
We're getting the idea. But remember, there's positive and negative aspects. You're actually increasing force on both sides, depending on how you're using it. But if you look at the exercise, we're going to swing up. This is the beginning. So your wrist is basically down. Then pops up. Okay, so different things are happening here. You're working the shoulder girdle, the body by moving the weight, constricting the core, right? And the machine that operates all the weapons. This, you can focus your energy down to where this is training the positive aspect of the drop. And you can also focus your energy up where it's, you're training the positive energy coming up. And you'll find that you can do this on the fly. You can change either way you're doing it. With the weight, you're doing it with the resistance, so you're getting that return effect from the weight, making the muscles, the ligaments, tendons, everything stronger, and you're feeling how it's working. So
the goal would be to pop it with the weight, so when you do it For real, it's like
come up. Now you can go slower and work the static. You can come up, work the pop. Now watch this. I can come up and hit underneath like you were there, but also you come up and work the bottom. Remember the 1-inch punch, right?
Yeah, I was working on that happening earlier.
But watch, let's say I got 1 inch between that front knuckle and him. What's the difference between the bottom knuckle and his chest? That's where all the travel happened. So that 1-inch punch that Bruce was hitting everybody with, he had about a 5-inch punch. Because what happens is, it's here, that bottom part had all kinds of travel to develop power. Not that he wasn't amazing, he was. But it's kind of, if you look at it, you may be touching me, right? But look how far this is off.
Yeah.
So you have a lot of space.
And it's always that.
Sorry. No, I like to trace.
Well, that's good.
Sorry, I killed him.
No, you're fine.
I broke it in my toe.
So, back. Up. Back is really basic. Well, basic, straight out, pull back. Straight out, up, pull back. So step, here. The light, the
rings.
I was like, I'm going to have a call, damn it. Here.
Rings are dangerous.
Yes. That can be very destructive. That's basically what Joe Palm, right? Then you go backwards. Same thing. You can put more dynamics in it. You can move your hips more, stretch further. Actually, everything square first. Where I keep all my weapons online.
You want to know where your box is.
For me, that's why I start out. Then you grow from there, like you did last night. Remember you started adding and extrapolating?
Oh, good. Yes.
Next progression is out, up, down. Out, up, down. Out, up, down. Out, up, down.
So keeping the bridge still?
Keeping your bridge. Without the weight, there's one, two, three. One, two, three. Start though. Who wants to go first? Thumb to the circle.
He's my senior.
And then what you'll do.
It's a weird relationship.
Actually. With these, I've gone out to doing 35 pound plates. Okay? It takes a while to get there. You start with 5, then you go to 10, then you go to 10 to 5, then you go, or 20 or 25, right? So out, the pump, to your own chin, and then back. Forward station. Feel that. Forward back. And then step. Front. All the way out. Pitch lever. And chamber wherever you chamber. You start here. Let it fall down and stretch everything. And then rotate it back up and let it stretch down. And you will feel this tie-in working, right? Then you bring it back up and down. And do it. Like if you have your 8-pound sledge, it was just average weight, you choke up at first on it so that the head's close to the hand, it's not tearing the muscle and tendon, doesn't weigh a ton, right? You get it at the end of this lever, that's going to be a lot of weight. Okay? So you grip it wherever you need to choke up on it to where you can do, if you can't do it 9 times, just get it. Because those, we're talking small joints, small ligaments and tendons, right? So chamber. Work your rotations, okay? Come down. Swing it up. Drop like you're hammering into the sky. You're working this part of the wrist, right? So those are going to be up at the top. Then you're going to bring it down. You're going to go here.
Down.
Lift it up. This way.
Which way? Oh,
up.
That one.
Okay, here's that. So you're doing that. That's actually will work just fine for those exercises. Okay, so the hammer's better because why? Orientation. Mm. That's why you get the hammer with the 18-inch length. Stretching out.
Oh, it's because we kind of pulled into it for one of our
moves. You're coming here, right?
Yeah.
This is bringing the pull up. This
that
way.
That works the wrist. What I was
saying. And striking foot.
I can see that already.
Right. That's what I was
well, with this length, with the hammer, it's shorter.
and you get the more of that torque feeling, then you get this big long kind of motion. You can, obviously you can do these, right? Your wrist exercises with the bow down this way. You bring it up, but it goes to the back, so you're hammering into the sky, right? Watching the baby. No, I didn't. How was this? I wasn't like.
Okay.
No. Look at that. You're so mean. I was watching his little hair. Alright, so. Again, tap baby in the head. Come over here. All the same things can be done with a bow. Okay, but I prefer the hammer because then you can do these. And it's similar to the iron plate. What I will do is I will do a rotation out and a rotation back. Same step, rotation out, rotation back. And you can do a rotation up and back with the jar pointing forward, okay? And then we will do up extension, right? In the hand position, the weighted ball in, right? Come up like that. So you've got, come up, strength builder, just a strength builder. You've got blocking rotation. Okay. You've got jar block, rotate, come down. Jar block, rotate, come down. You've got rotate around, rotate back. Really hard. That's this one here. The difference is the jar block, you turn, work your jar, then come around and come down. The other one is you're grabbing, you're just kind of coming up, and you're coming with a circle. Those are very, very hard. And then you, it's all on the canvas. And you play. Oh. You buy a 10-pound thing of beans for a few dollars, start with 5 pounds, and use a small, that lid's too big. Even for my hand, that's hard to reach. So, that's just exchange, right? The biggest one comes on this side, honestly. I'm just showing that as an example. The reason I'm going to do that, let's go again. Uh-oh. That's the canvas. Exactly. That's not facing. You push down really hard, take him here. Because again, if I take him straight back, he can hit me in front of the back, right? The fist. Okay? And if I take him this way, I facilitate a spin and a direct return. So my safest option is to take him this way. Energy's that way. So even if he does spin, I've given it some kind of...
Yeah, you can see what's coming.
That's what I wanted.
More translating to power. Okay. Now if your foot's coming, I better get close to you or get all the way away, because either way I'm dead. I don't. Look at the base exercises for my traditional... the first thing we're going to do is I'm going to let you watch first. We're going to cycle out the watcher, and that way everybody gets a chance to look at it and do it. Okay? So we're going to start here. You guys kind of follow along. We talked about this a little bit. Let's move that way so we don't change our footing for you and I. That's good, because you're going to be able to move the circle. Okay, so we're going to come across. Now, there's different ways to do this motion. We talked about that a little bit last time. Basic is just straight, and it's a middle block and a down block. It's a middle block and a down block, open-handed. What we're going to do, we're going to do my way. I like my way. Right? My way is a jar. And then here, and then come down. Chamber.
So you here. Want so, you come up and down.
You guys do the jar block, right?
Yeah.
You do the jar block?
Yes.
And you call it what? In the movement? Box out?
Bone
saw, that's what I thought. Make sure I have it right. Repetition here is more important than intensity.
It's more important than going so hard that it kills you. If you can't do it at least 18 times without pulling away because it's trying to hurt that, you gotta wake up. Okay? This is akin to building brick walls. Like, you throw all the mortar and all the bricks, and you make a 20-foot high wall in a half an hour, it's never gonna stand. Why? The mortar at the bottom has to set up before you can add more. Okay? If you don't give it time to set up, the walls are gonna be. Okay, rotate down. Rotate out, rotate down. Bronze, up, down, chamber, down. You're back in. Up. Four. Okay, so while we're starting, we're going to 1-1. 2-2. Step. 3-3. Step. Back to back. Rotate. You're going to step 3-4. Just pass. Hit. Hit. Now, step back. Step forward. Through. Strike. Strike 1, 2, 3. No, one turn. Back to back. That's later, right? 1-1. Back. Adjust. The third. Step, step. It's okay. Rotate square up like that. Okay? On the third one, and you step not through. We're square here, right? So to the middle, and there. Because we're fighting here now.
Okay, so my middle.
That's because you're 9 feet tall.
That's what I'm saying. Okay,
but,
so mine was just the
bottom. But your middle is only in reference to yourself. Our middle is the middle between us. Right?
Yes.
So then you come up in the middle. Good. Just like that. Come on in here. And then, now back and over, straight back, and square. You should be about
that one back.
Fist your chamber down. So, cross, up, down, up, down, step, down, back, back. Down, straight back, square where you're going to go, up, down, down, up, down, here, up, down, straight, square. Now, that's the basic, right? My understanding was that this was the original Shaolin way when they were doing it in Shaolin, that's what I was told. I have no idea if that's credible or not. That's just information that's passed down to me. Don't know. Never been to Shaolin, not a monk. But that's what I was told. Okay. But it makes sense that a lot of our stuff comes from that area, right? That direction. So here's the other way, which is what your tendency was. And yours, because it's natural. Okay? They wanted to train that stop motion and that back to back, because there's very few times we're going to train that. And it was a nice spot to put it in. And it teaches some dynamics that aren't going to normally happen. Okay, so this time, we're going to cross, up, down, step, up. Yeah, this time, this is also harder footwork. I'm gonna step through and set up. Turn with the motion, with the hand and the feet tied. Turn instead of coming through here. This is already here. So we're going to turn to the left and then go to the right. So we've got left, right, and left, right, right. So I'm going to come through and hit left and then right. Now I'm back starting right, left, right. Go through, left. Next time they're not being back. Right. Step through. Left hitting as you step in. That make sense? Okay. Once you guys pair up, I'll watch that. Let's actually do this one first. I'm turning and hitting the left as you go through. Let's start with you two. Are you guys watch? I'll watch. Thank you. You guys can take one turn. Okay, we did the kotekitai, which is the arm banging or the, what do you call it, the temperament. There's other exercises. All of those additional exercises are added by me or added by somebody for whatever purposes. We have a lot of them. I got a lot of them through Frank Sifu. Two different systems and things that I've trained, this Muay Thai or this Filipino stuff. And everything works with your drills, push-ups, sit-ups, hitting the bag. We make you a better fighter because you're building skills or strengths or some kind of aptitude or ability that makes your fighting better. But you're not going to do push-ups when you fight, put a heavy bag when you fight, but still, the things they develop make your fighting better, right? Mm-hmm. That's how you look at different drills and things that are outside your system. As long as a minimum, and I would say, this has been my guideline, but 60% of the time you spend training should be doing your traditional stuff. Do your forms. Do your basics. Do your drills. Then add this week. We're going to train this from what Wade brought us. We're going to do that this week for half hour. The next week, when Frank Sifu came down, he did this. Let's do that for an hour next week. And then the week after that, we cross-trained with the Kaiju Kenbo guys, and they did this thing with footwork. Let's do all our stuff and get our basic core working. We've trained our system. Let's do 20, 30 minutes on that. So that's what that just adds to your fighting, makes you better. Like sometimes you can go running, sometimes you lift weights, sometimes you lift that. But 60% of your martial arts time should be spent on your base system. Because you're always going to return to your base. You're going to return to your natural instinct, right? You're going to return where I'm going to go, right? You have JT food, because that's who you are, right? So 60% of you is your core system. Another 20% is your natural instinct, your natural process. 20% of what you do when you fight and you do anything else is going to come from outside sources. Books, magazines, videos, visitors, different systems, movies, whatever. So if you're training in a balance, you're fighting in a strong. Okay. Next exercise, put your right foot near mine. Perfect. Chamber high, chamber low, wherever you chamber. What this is our basic push-up exercise. I'm going to keep my fingertips pointing up. You're going to push down. I'm going to break parallel, but not allow my arm to lock. I want to come close to a lock, but I want to control it and not let him lock my arm. I want to see where lock is, and I want to stop short of that. And I'm going to come up and come out to where my mechanics limit. I can't move any further this way until I turn and push down. Okay, so come back in. Push down. So there's my first movement. Up and out. Then it turns and I push down. If you resist, I can't move you. Why? Good reason, but there's a more simple reason. It's because you're in an eccentric contraction. I'm a concentric contraction. Fingers lifted weights. What's your max bench?
2.
Okay, you can take 400 pounds on a bench, and you can lower it under control, maybe 4 pounds. Lower it all the way down under control. It ain't moving, but you can control it slowly to a stop. So my point is that, let me have that. Okay. Is that if I'm pushing down, let's say we both bench 250. If you're stopping, I can't move you. You're going to stop me right there. Only if there's a big disparity in strength can this person, the concentric contraction, move the eccentric. That's going to have to be a pretty big disparity in strength. We don't have it. I'm not that much stronger. I don't think. I'm not, I know you lift weights and you've got some good core strength. So let me move you and come to a slow stop. We'll go to a lock. That locked? Come up right there. Little lock. Come up right there. Sure, if you have a dial indicator right here. You just go by your feel.
Okay.
Go by what you get.
That's not very good.
So come up. And then come a little early. But you want to come all the way here. Then you feel that stop? Then if you push over, then I have to turn to resist. Okay, we're going up and then down. Push. I'm gonna stop here. Turn your hand. So I'm gonna come up. The person's really strong. I may have to roll some of my legs. I need my legs to get them to start. Fingertips, always point to the ceiling. When you first start out, fingertips up. So you're stopping me?
Yes.
Your core's getting tired, but your arm, you're not letting me move. And then let that arm, there, almost straight. Good. What you're going to do, try to come to a controlled stop where you're controlling how far the person pushes down. So if you push down, I'm going to come to here. Not lock, but close. I'm going to come up, and you're going to resist. Let it come over. What you want to do is you want to keep this to your side, square up on me and your body. Bring it up to 45 degrees. And let it come down. This is locked. Curl elbow. Come to here and train. And every once in a while, you're your training partner, your training partner, go to a lock and feel that stretch. If it's hard to stop something, if you don't understand it, but if you need to train, you carefully train that lock and go to lock, right? And then come out of the lock. Right? And then come all the way and scoot your elbow. All the way. Scoot your elbow. All the way. Push. Push. I let it lock. It becomes a strike. And that change point happens in a lot of different movements. Sure, because you might be limited. Let's say this punch comes to me here, right? I'm trying to take it past. Well, I can't, I can push it out, but I need to turn so I can change how I'm going to do it and what we're doing. So that change, that moment's important. If that makes sense. So what we're doing there, remember I said 45 degrees? Think about why. If we're here, we have our hands here. Right? This is our apex is 0, right? This is 90 degrees, right? So this is 45, this is 45. Guess what? This is 45, this is 45. Guess what? That's 45, that's 45. That angle is all important with someone bringing a technique to you, right? And here's why. This is my understanding, this is where I've taken the understanding of the drills, the application, and the fighting, and put it into the mechanics and understandings where I can apply it to everything else I do and making the connection. Okay? So, is that...
Yes,
that's weird. We've been here a long time.
No, we were in Texas. Well,
good.
I actually dropped it down on here. I was like, oh, okay.
The thing you're going to find out in every system, whether it's mine or yours or whatever, even between the two, everything is connected to everything else. Everything's interrelated. you're going to see an aspect of that here, right? You're going to see an aspect of this here. He wants to force your hand down, right? But steer it into him. So suddenly you've got a strike, right? So there you go. They're all connected, always. Okay, now let's talk about that 45 degrees. Just briefly, so you get that understanding. We're here, okay? This punch comes at me. I want that punch to go away from me at about approximately 45 degrees.
Why is that?
No, I'm asking.
Wait, why am I
trying to pull away, pull away, pull away. You notice that, like, pull down? That's what I kept doing, pull down, right? So watch. Get me here. Get me here. Dead space. Get me here. Dead space. Get me here. Dead space. 45 is dead space. The reason we do this at 45. Force my hand. I'm going to take him off at 45. The reason I want to do that is it takes him to dead space. If he's forcing me down, you know, I let it happen this way. Right? So he's forcing it down. I don't want to take it straight, because if I take it straight through, you just have this. Right? Force it down again. If I come here, I've given him this moment. What I want to do, so I'm taking, now force it down. Dead space. Where he doesn't have a return option.
Right.
Send him to never ever. Right? Same thing on a punch. Let's say we're coming in. Don't push down, push down. Drill. Drill. He comes in my face. 45. Jamming up. Right. If I take him that direction, I can move his power away. A mistake. Cool. Now come in, come up high. If I let him come straight in, right on top. If I push him this way, this comes. In the manner that it takes it off at an angle.
Okay.
So if the punches are coming in this way, they're coming in the lower, that space comes here, take it to that area, comes here. Now if I jam it, that's different. I'm attacking. Okay. But if you're going to come past me, I want to try to not, okay, punch here, do this. I'm already hit it fast.
Right.
I'll add this momentum.
So if you're gonna hit past the 45, it has to be hit, not just the block.
For my application, yeah. And again, the one coming here, right? If I take it too straight, here, whatever. I want to try to get it offline enough, but not so much that I facilitate something else.
Right.
And there's a little window of dead space. Minor detail, but just something to think about. Same thing with a kick, right? Because, watch, kick, okay? I just facilitated that back kick. Just got hit the burn on that back. Or in your case, I got my head kicked. Right? Because if we're here, okay, when I do this, I'm already hit. Already hit. When that kick comes, me? Okay. I got to put it in the spot, because I didn't want to put it back.
Okay.
Good. I was disrespectful. Yeah. Literally hurt this one, I want to. Notice what I did there? When I flew here, I cradled it. Moved my arm to support it. Right? So I want to take care of our brothers and sisters. So the thing is, that same kick, if I do this, oh, let me just make this kick a little harder. Like pull start engine. Right? So you can dead stop it, you can drive it into the ground, but if you're going to give it a direction,
especially with a good kicker, someone big and strong, someone fast. All right. Let's say this hand comes into here, and I do this.
Wow,
Marty. I want to try to suppress the dead energy. And it's never going to happen consciously when you're fighting.
No.
But your habits have to develop. Right? So when that punch comes to get me, I want to bring it to a dead spot.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
Versus I can do the same thing. What? You can't hit me. See, that is more, you already felt your back, didn't you?
Yeah.
Right? So close. Bang! I'm hit. Instead, what I want to do, suppress, deaden that force, if I can.
Yeah, well, like if he grabs my hair, I mean, my momentum's stuck right
you
there.
You can still come over the top of the
I still can, but it's stuck at that moment, and I have to really try to
get it. You have to switch gears. And sometimes the lippers have been getting it's a bad one. I know, but woken up going, huh? What?
Yeah.
You bobbed and you should have. You went like this and you should have just did that. Because you went straight into it. So I woke up going, wrong move. But your habits build as you're sparring, right?
Yep.
Yes. So you'll see a lot of people's big hits to do what? Knock it out of the way. What happens if they knock your arm out of the way? You're going to hit with an elbow or a backspin or your kick. It's just an idea. And you're all advanced kind of levels to where you can go, oh, I see if you can punish that. So that's, you got the end, 45 degrees. You have your arm banging, stepping, right? And that's two of our big ones. And you got to go through, you know.
I can leave you all here. He has a key. And I'm just going down the road. My daughter gets out of school at 3:15.
Well, I've got to be done pretty soon myself. I'll give you one more thing and then we can wrap if you want.
We have
to
get a picture.
Yes.
Of course.
One.
He's determined on selling
your. Go square. Yes. Go for contact. You don't give both reach. Yeah. Right? Right foot back. Short fighting stance. Now, can I reach him?
No.
So, one person steps back, you step back, other person steps forward. This is where we train this from. I start right here. Okay. What you do is he's going to come with that back hand right at my head. No step. We're already in range. You need to, like you're going to hit, and then you're going to go for a low shot. And I'm going to hit him. You miss, you get hit. Rising block. Low block. Ab block. Low block. Ab block. Low block. High. Low. And we train this. Fist block. Fist block. You're going to find out about three of you going. Just been doing up and down. Not crazy. As long as you can reach, right? You can reach up and hit, you can reach up and hit me. You can reach up and hit, right? We're in range. Okay, so we're not gonna kill each other, but we're gonna feel it a little. As you punch, you can do soft.
I already got hit once.
So, we'll switch. To my coming pad. Okay. So that back hand can definitely reach the punch. So this is pressure training. He punches. Block. Oh, hesitating. You punch, huh?
Okay. I can't hit you.
You can! It's here. You can't hit a G. You can't hit me.
Oh my god. Go on, Ecker.
Too nice,
Ecker. Look.
Don't break my knuckles.
He's not trying
that.
It's
like, ah, no. Just punch me in the cheek. It's like, snark.
You got a gift for the eye?
Okay.
That's another thing you have to work on too. When you partner up, is everybody has a tendency to try to go
the way
most practitioners.
You know why? Because you have a kind heart, and that's the first thing you want to have with the heart. Everything else comes after. So let's do a quick bow. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
If you could bow us out, listen.
Thanks. That's good to see you.